Hello, Bent, and thank you very much for agreeing to speak to us. I have to say that it's a great pleasure to get to speak to you because I've admired your music for a very long time. And even if we come from the same part of the world, I haven't met you before until now. So thanks for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Your piece, Eveningland, let's talk about that first. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It was commissioned from New York. And I think half a year before I started to write the piece, but I knew that I should compose it. I was in New York, and me and my wife were sitting in one of those tall buildings, and we was looking out, and we could see all the light, all the flashes, hear all the noises of sirens and all that. And suddenly, having that picture in my head, I remembered another picture. In a way, the quite opposite picture. When I was a little boy, there was I had a sequence where I was standing in my parents' bedroom and looking out at the countryside. We were living in the countryside. I was looking at fields. I think there was a cow standing there. There was far away. There was trees and wood. I could see the wood as far away. So it was like a little boy looking at the both at the future, but also at the big world surrounding him. And but particularly there was a certain light there. It was in the sort of the late afternoon, the beginning of the evening. So it was sort of the darkness in the, even that it was summertime was on sort of on its way. And I don't know why I remember that, and it always been a part of me. And one of the strange things about human being is that we can't sort of decide what we should remember. So I thought in the piece Eveningland, it was two different evenings, one with on the top of New York and the other one on the bottom of the countryside of Zealand. The piece begin with the evening from my childhood. It starts with a violin solo muted so much that it's almost inaudible. And I think for me, that is not something I thought about when I wrote it, but that is maybe the boy looking out. And what happens in the music is after a while, the orchestra arrives sort of coming from the background, as the trees and the fields and the world was coming to me when I was standing there looking. In the end of writing the piece, my father-in-law got very ill and got cancer, and that was terrible. And he was an oboe player. He was actually a very, very famous professional oboe player in Denmark, Frederik Gislinge. He really wanted to come to New York and hear this piece. But then he was afraid because he's got ill. And I said to him, well, now, Frederick, you have to come because I write you an oboe solo. And unfortunately, he died before the premiere. And the oboe solo is sort of a memorial of him. And that's why it also end up like it sort of end up in the very high register as it's sending a little, some small warm wishes and regards to him in his heaven. And so you could say it started with a violin solo. My father played the violin, and then it ended with the oboe solo. My father-in-law played the oboe. So it's that's sort of the personal thing. And generally, I'm a quite autobiographical composer, which means that it's not that I write my whole life every day. It's just that it's a bit of a cliche, but I find it difficult to separate my personal life with the way I compose. So it's always something. If I meet sounds, they sort of in immediately sort of became a part of my inspiration, etc. So that's why it is like that.
You know, it's obvious from when you describe the piece that it's got certain layers to it. There's it's a little bit programmatic about what New York looks like, but then there's also a story behind. And I've always wanted to ask you, I've sort of imagined that you like to listen to sounds very close. So you talk about the piece being, about this big thing in New York. But then when I listen to it, I can hear sort of a fascination with how instruments make sound at the same time. It's all so micro and it's so small at the same time. Is that a theme in your music as well?
Well, I think actually that there is, of course, the reflection of my own life. And that sometimes is going directly into the music. One of the funniest examples is when I met my wife, I said to her, well, I won't forget you. So I put in a gong stroke immediately today in my piece, and there is a gong stroke there. And then the whole thing about composing that way is, of course, it should fit together. And it's only working because it actually worked with a gong stroke there. The only reason why it was there was because it was fitting into the music. And that's a kind of this to be open for inspiration. There is a famous example is, I think, that when Elgar wrote the Garantius Dream, he in one of his letters says, it's quite funny, I walk out in the street and all the birds are singing my music, because it seems that you're so much involved in the music that you think actually that everything is about what you're writing at the moment. It could also be that a lot of contemporary composers are using computers and they hear the music before it's played. And I'm not capable of working on a computer. So I write everything in the hand. And when you do that, it's like it's also a very, very close process to what you actually are doing. It's a handcraft. It's a mystery. You create a mystery also because I'm not a very good piano player, and I'm basically trust my inner ear more than my the ears from a computer. So I just sit and write, and then it becomes quite a it's very natural in a way to me. It's just the music I hear in my head, and of course the music you hear in your head is something to do with yourself, and then in that way it becomes autobiographical.
That is absolutely fascinating, because that's what I always imagined before having met you, that your music has music in the normal sense, notes written on the piece of paper, but your music doesn't sound right if the musician doesn't understand that there's lots of actual environmental sounds, things that transcend just, you know, a normal musical scale. For example, you use microtones a lot, and you use a lot of glissandos and things like that, which kind of, you know, explode the whole sound spectrum. I learned that your music really sort of stands out. It's extremely complicated, but it has one thing different from all kinds of other music that's being written right now, I think, is that it's always very idiomatic of the instrument. One thing is what you take from the environment, but you write very well for the instruments. You knew exactly what instrument to put it in to get exactly that right sound. And that puts a big demand on the musician as well to be able to see it in the same way. Also, in your music, there's always melody. Is that fair to say that it's a big theme in your music, that there's always melody?
Well, I think it's gradually coming. I think when I was younger, the pieces sort of in the 80s and the beginning of the 90s, I was sort of afraid of the melody. I was afraid of the sort of that it became too concrete in a way. So it was almost like traces of melodies. And I think getting older, I am not so afraid about it. And I write melodies, and I also sometimes write melodies that I should be able to hum when I take a shower. I really like sometimes when I'm walking around humming a melody, and I think to myself, where is that from really? What is it? I can't really recognize it. Oh God, that's from your piano trio or something. I suddenly do that. And I even one day, my wife walks around and sing a melody. And I remember when we did the clarinet concerto, there is a theme which is very, very simple, a little melody that's very simple. And Martin said to me that when he walked out, then he could hear the melody still hummed by some of the audiences. And that for a certain moment, I thought, then you have succeeded in a way, because I don't want to avoid melodies. I just don't want to make them totally banal in a way. I just have a feeling of when a melody is right. And I think that is one of the things that is gradually been changing in my music, that the melodies can be more in front. I think it came also very much when I started to write opera, because I wanted to write melodies in an opera and some other pieces with singing. And then at the same time, gradually my micro intervals has disappeared. They are still there because I use glissandi, and there's still a few of them. But it's like I feel I can do my music with a bigger simplicity. I try to investigate, not as a scientist, but as a composer, the instrument. And all the times when I have been writing concertos for musicians, I have not sort of got all the tricks in forehand. I want to discover the instruments myself. So I change, always change an instrument to become my music instead of changing my music to become a new instrument.
And that is extremely encouraging to hear from me, because I've always wondered about that particular thing as well. The pieces that I have played from you before have very intricate markings in the music. And part of me says that I should do exactly what it says on the page, and I need to interpret every tiny little detail and put nothing else into it. But another side of me says that I need to follow it and then let other things come in. Let the experiment take over and let accidents happen at the same time. And it's when I play your music like that I feel I get in touch with it the most.
I mean, when I was younger, I was more afraid about that people wouldn't do it exactly the same way. And I think I was could be quite a fascist when I was having rehearsal with musicians, because I wanted it a specific way. Nowadays, I really sort of hope that the musician are sort of recomposing the piece when they're playing them, because I think that's very important to me. And if a musician plays something by me and change the dynamic, change some of the tempi and say, well, I would like to do this fast, I would like to do this slower, what do you really mean forte here? Because I think it's a pianissimo part. Then I let it go, really, because I say, just do it, because I'm not interesting to hear the same piece of music done the same way all the time. That's how music becomes alive. I think it was different when I was younger, because at that time, when you wrote a piece, you was very scared about that would be the only piece you ever wrote and the only time you ever hear it. So that at that time was very important. But I've become more, I'm much more open for interpretation.
That's brilliant to hear, and certainly for a musician like me, music to my ears, because when you play like that, you feel like you actually have a conversation with the composer at the same time, and is why I like playing your music so very much. Thank you very much, Bent. It's a shame you couldn't be here in person for tonight's concert, but hopefully we'll get you back to Scotland soon.
Thank you, Dávur.